Hello, my name is Marie Mullaney and this is Just In Time World. Welcome to today's episode on polytheism in fantasy. Polytheism is the belief in multiple gods, and what I want to discuss today is how you can use it in fantasy world building to both build out your mythology, make your world more fantastical, and drive your story. How I'm going to break down today's video is I'm going to talk about the different models of polytheism, labeling distinct gods and the host model, and I'm then going to talk about designing portfolios and assigning gods to those portfolios, in essence, how to build your pantheon in a polytheistic religion. I'm going to discuss how magic and the gods impact each other, and then I'm going to discuss creating organizations that support your religion. In other words, creating churches and rituals and the mythology around your gods. And finally, I am going to discuss how you can use polytheism to drive your story, whether that is your story in a fantasy novel or your story in a tabletop role-playing game. It's a lot of content, so let's get cracking. Just before we do start, if you like this kind of content, please do hit the thumbs up button. It helps make sure that the content doesn't get buried by the YouTube algorithm. Okay, off we go. First, let's talk about models of polytheism. It would be simple to say that polytheism is simply the belief in multiple gods, but it's not entirely the only way to approach it. You could have polytheism in a labeling sense. So what I mean by that is it's the same deity, but it's called different things by different cultures. The Roman and Hellenistic polytheism, Roman and Greek polytheism, is a very good example of labeling. Zeus is the same god as Jupiter. It is the same god, but the Romans labeled him differently. The Romans, in fact, were absolutely expert labelers. This kind of labeling is common when you have a single pantheon that you reuse in different cultures. So it's quite common in fantasy systems. The author that I've seen used it to the greatest effect, used this technique of labeling to the greatest effect, was Trudy Canavan in her The Age of the Five book. I highly recommend it if you're interested in stories with a polytheistic religious drive. It's a very good series of books. Labeling is often also used when your gods are elemental driving forces rather than actual personified beings. And then those driving forces are labeled by different names by different cultures. And at the heart of those names is not a being, but an elemental force. This is the way that Catherine Kerr uses her gods in her cosmology in the Devery world. But labeling isn't the only way to approach polytheism. You could literally have distinct gods worshipped by distinct cultures. In such a case, Zeus and Odin would be different beings. They could meet at the pub and have a beer and discuss how much they hate their sons. This would be then completely distinct entities. There is a downside to this kind of polytheism. While it gives you a lot of scope for having different theological entities and different worship, it does mean that you have a lot of divine beings to keep track of. Also, I don't really see, let's say each culture had five different gods. And I mean, that's quite a small pantheon, right? And you have 10 cultures. You're looking at 50 divine beings cooperating to form a cohesive natural world. That seems unlikely. So you would probably need a different set of mythos for what created the world. If you do want to go with such multiple divine beings, like literal divine beings in each polytheistic culture that you have, I would personally go with some kind of mechanic for how spirits or people become deities, or I would go with a modified form of animism, and I will discuss animism in detail in a future video. Yeah, I don't know. It feels very awkward for writing. Maybe you can pull it off. Maybe you've seen somewhere where it's been pulled off really well. Let me know in the comments. Then lastly, you can use the host model. So the host model I'll also discuss in more detail in monotheism because it's quite commonly used there. But the host model is in effect when you have a central godhood, like a creator being or a driving spirit, but they're quite remote from humanity. And they are generally not worshipped. Instead, worship is redirected at their helpers, at the hosts that surround them. A classic part of polytheism is that you have multiple gods that cover portfolios of activities. So when you're creating your fantasy world, designing your pantheon, putting together your band of gods, is one of the critical elements to creating a polytheistic religion. I find that creating that pantheon is easiest if you first create your portfolios that you want to cover. Your portfolios come from three different areas. As I discussed in a previous video, religion serves two major purposes. One, it needs to answer the big questions. Why are we here? Why do we suffer, etc.? And two, it helps to mediate the social contract. So from those two elements come a lot of your portfolio. So from the big questions are things like life, war, and death, and the afterlife. All of those come from your big questions. All of those portfolios come from your big questions. And from mediating the societal contract, you get things like the portfolio of marriage, or the portfolio of family, or the portfolio of the home. And then, of course, you have portfolios that come from general life, like the portfolio of the ocean, the god of mountains, or professions, the god of the smiths. And all of these form portfolios. Now, you don't have to have a perfect match. It doesn't need to be one god, one portfolio. In fact, it would be more natural to have one god with many portfolios. So what I like to do is I like to break my portfolios down into those three categories of the big questions, the societal contract, and general life. And then give each god a portfolio in one of those three, so that you would have a god of love who is also the god of family. So it's the god of family love, who is also the god of flowers. And that gives that god then different feast days, and it starts to inform the mythology around the god, because now you can have celebrations of that god and that love involving giving each other flowers. So you start to build in a more complex nature in your god, given that they have a bigger portfolio. So when you're building your pantheon, design your portfolios and then delve deeper. And create your gods with multiple portfolios. So I spoke about how these portfolios impact on your mythology, which brings me to mythology, ritual, story, and the evolution of religion. The most important question that you're going to need to answer in your mythology is, where do the gods come from? Were they the creators of the universe? Or was there something that created them and now they look after the universe? Are they the children of the original creators? This is a very common trope. If you think about even in our own real world history, there were the Titans, which were born from the Sky Father and from Gaia, and then the giants and the Roman gods, and everybody kind of builds on each other in this fashion. So you need to decide your cosmology around your gods, and then based on that cosmology, that pecking order of the divine, decide how much do people know and how does that impact their mythos. A very interesting part of this kind of mythology and building your gods in this way is that it can happen that your gods get moved around on your world and that they get relabeled. Famously, as I said, the Romans relabeled the Greek gods. I mean, the Roman pantheon is the Greek pantheon, just with different names. But this isn't the only time that that kind of movement has happened. The Orisa, which I referenced before, were taken to America by the transatlantic slave trade. As the Yoruba people were part of the transatlantic slave trade, they ended up in America with their religion. And it became part of what is now the voodoo religions. Now, there are more than just the Orisa involved, because Vadum is a hodgepodge of different faiths. But it's a very good example of that kind of layering growth. So if you want to have a truly fascinating religion, and it's one of the driving forces of your story or of your world, then think about how people moved with their gods. What happened when they went from one land to another, whether of their own volition or whether by a forceful removal like slavery, you know, or whether they were fleeing some great mishap, like there were refugees going to another land. What happened with their gods and their religion? And when they encountered another religion, did they smoosh together? Did they convert and bring elements of their own religion? Did they relabel? So those are very interesting questions to ask when you're building your religious history and your religious mythos. If you'd like me to explore this kind of relabeling topic more, let me know in the comments and I will make a future video covering how to do steps of evolution in a religion. Another thing that you need to define about your religion is the rites and rituals. Now, at a minimum, your religion needs some kind of birthright and some kind of deathright. And in a polytheistic sense, this would normally be covered with different gods. So there would be a god that a child is dedicated to when they are born, and there would be a god that handles funerals and the afterlife that you invoke during the rites of funeral. Again, if you'd like me to cover how to design rituals in general, comment below, let me know. It is very interesting when you're creating a polytheistic religion, rite, to have maybe multiple gods involved, or to have a single god, but if they have multiple portfolios, to bring their multiple portfolios into it. So it's interesting, for example, the Hades figure is also the god of wealth. So it's the god of the underworld, the god of wealth, the god of the afterlife. And it's interesting that the dead had to have pennies to take into the underworld to pay the ferryman, which kind of brings it full circle round to Hades being the god of wealth as well. So if you are designing those rituals for people who worship this polytheistic pantheon of yours, don't forget about their extra portfolios, and if you work them into the rituals of their main portfolio that gives those rituals that spark of life that really makes the world feel like a rich mythology. And then let's just segue briefly into magic and polytheism. And the reason why I specifically want to highlight this before I hit churches is because magic can have quite an impact on polytheism. So if magic is real and the gods are real, what is the marriage between the gods and magic? Is there a specific god of magic who governs the use of magic? Are the gods the source of magic, a la priest magic in D&D? Do the temples control magic? Now, this is very important because you could use magic to fake miracles. And Mercedes Lackey does this very well in her books around the sun priests set in the Voldemort universe. So there's a period where the sun priests fall away from the tenets of their religion. And because they fall away from the tenets of their religion, their god stops blessing them with miracles. But a lot of the sun priests, the priests are also magicians because the church strictly controls magic. So anybody who shows magical talent becomes part of the church, becomes part of the priesthood automatically. So the priests just fake the miracles. They just cast magic regardless, which is a very interesting approach in terms of, subverting the divine, if you will. And what then does the divine do? If the god is real, what does the divine eventually do about this? I won't spoil the story for you, but it's actually quite spectacular, and I recommend Mercedes Lackey's writing in that regard. You do need to think about, what impact does it have, and if one of your gods has the portfolio of magic, what impact does that have on magicians? Speaking of churches, let's talk about how you build a church. I feel like I'm running out of time in this video, and there's a lot to cover. So if you want me to discuss any specific aspect of church building more, let me know in the comments and I will get onto it. But basically, what you have to think about in a polytheistic sense is how much power does each temple have? Now, if you want to build a theocracy, like an actual religion is the rules kind of society, I would actually recommend going monotheism. There is, in polytheism, I think it is unlikely that you would have a theocracy simply because the temples themselves can have differing opinions, and because they're associated with different gods, it tends to become a problematic situation for a theocracy. But the temples would definitively have power. If you think about it in the Roman sense, Caesar was a priest. Entering the priesthood was often a path to power in the Roman societies, entering the various priesthoods. So you can definitely have church politics, and you can definitely have churches exercising political power, but it is unlikely to be a full-blown theocracy. You can, however, create a lot of tension by having the different churches have different opinions on how, the people should act. And you can have churches having feast days on the same day to try and compete with each other in terms of, getting the faithful to flock to them. So when you're building your churches and your church politics around it, think about how the churches, how the priesthoods interact. Don't forget to think about things like vestments and breakaway sects, which can obviously also make great elements to in building a comprehensive church mythology. Lastly, what I want to touch on is using polytheism to drive the story. Now, as I said in my Religion 101 video, polytheism is characterized by interference. Often the gods interfere in human lives. This can either be done overtly or it can be done subtly. So for a great example of how this was done very subtly, I'm going to turn to Kashiel's Dart and Jacqueline Carey. So in Kashiel's Dart, the main character is born as the chosen of one of the gods. And this is marked by the fact that in her eye, she has a red fleck. Then in the third book of the first trilogy, Kashiel's Avatar, there's a moment where the main character faces a terrible choice and she's being called to go into darkness and rescue a child. And she feels like this is too much and she says, please, can this cup pass me by? You know, words to that effect. She feels the gods leaving her. She feels their joy of life leaving her. And her lover says to her, you know, the red in her eye looked as though it was fading away. And then she says, actually, I'll take the risk. I'll throw the dice. I would rather have the gods in my life and try and do this thing than not have the gods in my life. And so she goes into this path of darkness. So that is an example of very subtle interference by the gods, where they're guiding their chosen one in a very, very subtle way. But you don't have to be that subtle about it. You can be overt and still tell a great story. In the Voldemort novels by Mercedes Lackey, the gods have these spirit companions that are humans, very wise humans, that are reincarnated as what amounts to telepathic animals. So they are horses in the case of the heralds, the fire cats in the case of the priests of Kars. And they provide very direct guidance to the humans that they are sent to guide, who are affecting direct life results. So instead of the gods coming down, there are these animal companions that provide the guidance of the gods to pivotal people, which is also a very interesting way of driving the story. If you want to drive the story by means of religion, by means of the gods interfering, polytheism is absolutely the way to go. It offers so much scope for that kind of interference by the divine and that kind of clashing interference by the divine. And that is my take on polytheism. My name is Marie Mullaney. This has been Just In Time Worlds, and I will see you soon for monotheism in a fantasy world.